Hello everyone, welcome to our afternoon session. We will be listening to three country reports from different countries, namely Spain, Switzerland, and Hungary, I think. The first one is from Spain, Ms. Raquel Borges. She is working at Valencia University, and she has been working on the Department of Administrative and Procedural Law, and also she's teaching criminal procedural law, gender and violence, mediation, procedural law 1 and procedural law 3. Now, without further comment, I would like to give the stage to Ms. Roquel to present his country report on Spain. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank the organization for giving me the opportunity of being here today. Always is a pleasure to collaborate with Istanbul University, and I hope to be able to do it in a presential way next year. I would also want to apologize for two questions. First of all, as you can see, we are working from home due to the coronavirus situation that nowadays is a little bit worse in Valencia than it was before. Therefore, I will turn off my camera during my presentation in order to be sure that there are no interference or cuts off. Second one is that due to this Friday ends the academic year in Spain, I will not be able to follow the rest of the Xamel School because we have plenty of master theses to evaluate and I am part of those panels. However, I will watch the other presentation of your channel when you upload them. So during my presentation, I will try to solve all the questions that were made to all the participants in this country report. In order to make it easier to follow the presentation, you will be able to see the questions in the slides that I am going to share now with all you. And after that, I will be really pleased to answer all the questions that my presentation should create on you. First question that you need to ask is our country a part of Istanbul Convention? And what are the main reservations regarding to the convention? We are a part of Istanbul Convention. And I think that one of the biggest problems that we have, and also one of the biggest problems from the rest of the world that asks us, our country, why have we done this? Is the concept of gender violence that our legislation uses. Our legislation defines gender violence in the Organic Act of Gender Violence. And it says that it's a violence that, as a manifestation of discrimination and the situation of inequality and power relationship of men over women, is exercised over women by those who are or have been their spouses or those who are or have been linked to them by similar relationship of affectivity, even without cohabitation. Consequently, we are not speaking about gender violence in a broad way. We are speaking about gender violence victims only for those women who are victims of gender violence by her partner or ex-partner. So if we go to the Istanbul Conventions, defines gender violence in the way that the United Nations do it. It's a violation of human rights and a form of discrimination against women that can be made in public or in private life. But it does not say that it has to be made by the partner or ex-partner. Therefore, here is the problem. Spanish legislation gives a different concept of gender violence than the international one. The difference is that while the international instruments understand gender-based violence as this violence exercised by men against women simply because they are women, our Organic Act limits gender violence to the violence that occurs in the context of a relationship of affectivity between a man and a woman. And in addition, includes minors in this concept of victims of gender-based violence. Since 2015, our legislator has said that the violence that suffer children within the home, because the violence is in order to act against the mother, is also gender violence victims. Furthermore, our Supreme Tribunal has said that minors can be also victims of gender violence without seeing the violence if they have to live in a home where you can feel that violence. For example, they are in the room, but they hear but they hear screams, they hear some kinds of acts that include violence, so they can imagine what is happening outside his room. However, more women victims of violence against women in Spain find protection beyond this law. In April 2014, Spain ratified the Istanbul Convention, and with the aim of offering greater protection to all victims of gender violence victims, the criminal code was reformed, because we wanted to be part of this convention and being able to be similar to the rest of the country. So among the numerous amendments, what our criminal code include was that gender was incorporated as a reason for discrimination among the circumstances that may motivate the aggravation of the penalty. Therefore, a murder should be 10 years, but if this murder is because of gender reason, we can aggravate the penalty of the murder a few years. Also, we have the Pact of States that, in accordance with the Istanbul Convention, established the legal obligation to include all victims of gender violence in a broad sense within the statistics of women victims of gender violence. Why? Because previously, the only victims that we had recorded as gender violence victims were the ones of the organic act that I told you before. So only those women that were victims from her partner or ex-partner were part of gender violence victims. But those who were victims by strangers for gender reasons weren't in these statistics. Salty famous victims as Diana Kerr or Laura Luermo, they both were murdered by strangers for gender reasons, and they weren't in these statistics. Nowadays, they should be included in these statistics in order to visualize all the victims of gender violence. I have to say that even though our concept is different to the rest of concepts, I am in favor of the definition offered by the Organic Act with respect of gender, because although it is true that it moves away from the concept of gender violence offered by international instruments, we have to check two situations. First one, Spain is a secure place for women. We are able to go abroad in the street without thinking that we are gonna be kidnapped or we are gonna be raped or murdered. The human rights violation that normally women suffer in Spain are inside the home. This is why our legislator wanted to check about this kind of a specific violation and say that it was against human rights. And the second one, the moment we just look inside the home, we realize a sad situation that is that children in Spain also suffer the most violations within the home. And this is why the inclusion of minors as a passive subject of this type of violence is a waste move. Second question is, how is domestic violence and violence against women defined in my legislation? Okay, so our concept of gender violence, according to the Organic Act of Gender Violence, includes minors and reduce women only to those who suffer violence within the framework of an affectivity relationship. including minors and reducing women victims of this violence means that we deal with the concept of gender according to our legislation, that we are referring to a concept that is not used in other European countries. Professor Lorenzo Capello indicates that including women and minors as a passive subject of this same crime has a paradox, that the one who least fits in the protective perspective in which the family relationship of subception and vulnerability are centered in today's society is the women. In the 21st century in Spain, there are not legal or natural reasons that relegate women to a situation of dependence or domination in the domestic context. On the contrary, our legislation recognizes us fully equality with our partners. So the situation of women cannot be assimilated to the children ones. While children, we can say that they are naturally vulnerable because of his age, women is the aggressor, the one who makes them vulnerable through violence. Next question that you have made is, if is violence against women accepted as discrimination based on gender? So yes, as I have previously said, in our criminal code, there is an aggravating factor of committing the act for gender reasons. If you ask me about acts of domestic violence against women in the criminal code, on the one hand, we have recognized special types of crime. The Organic Act of Gender Violence recognized the specific violence suffered by women in the domestic sphere as gender violence. In addition, with the aim of adapting to the Istanbul Convention, we have the circumstances that increase the punishment if a crime was committed by gender motives. We have, on the one hand, aggravating circumstances of committing the crimes for gender reasons, but we also have the mixed circumstance of family connections. And this family connection may aggravate or reduce the penalty. When we are speaking about the mixed circumstance of family connection, what we are speaking about is, for example, if a person helps another one to commit a suicide because his wife have a long illness or a depression, in this time, the mixed circumstance of family connection would reduce the penalty of that one who helps to commit the suicide. But if instead of helping the person to commit the suicide is the one who introduced in her head the idea of committing a suicide, the mixed circumstance what will do will be to aggravate the penalty. Actually, this circumstance is the most complicated to apply. So it will signify a reduction of the penalty. It is only accepted in situations of compassion in which the murderer wants to relieve the pain suffered by his victim. Next question is the role of the victim complaint in the investigation and prosecution of acts of domestic violence and violence against women. Here, I think that in Spain, we have something special because as a general rule, crimes of gender violence are public. Therefore, if these crimes are public, it means that can be prosecuted without a complaint from the victim. If a neighbor sees something and calls the police, it will start a criminal procedure. If the prosecutor has notices that something is happening inside a home, it will start also a criminal prosecution. But with sexual assault case, we consider these cases as semi-public crimes. What does it mean? That the prior complaint of the victim is necessary to investigate this crime. That is to say that the victim has to go to the prosecutor and tell him that she was raped and she wants to start a criminal procedural. The moment the victim says that to the prosecutor, this crime becomes public. So if the victim does not want to continue with this procedural, she cannot do anything because she made it public the moment she told this notice to the prosecutor. However, if the prosecutor knows that it has been a rape, because let's say is online because there are some videos, and the prosecutor speaks with the victim, and the victim says to the prosecutor that she does not want to start this criminal procedure because she thinks she's not capable to confront her aggressor, without the denounce of the victim, prosecutor cannot investigate the rape. Maybe he can investigate other crimes that should be committed, as for example, the act of sexting, that is a crime that we have that includes sending a picture or a video with sexual implications to other people. But in order to investigate the rape, is it necessary that the victims give their consent in order to do that? The measures regarding domestic violence and violence against women, we have a lot of measures. We have private law measures, we have criminal procedure measures, we have also, so in Spanish protection order, have both civil measures. Some of the civil measures will be, who will stay in the home? What to do with the custody of the children? We also have criminal measures. Criminal measures normally are three. First one is the prohibition to approach the victim. Second one is the prohibition to communicate. And third one is the provisions to reside in certain places. These measures can only be dictated by a judge, and both the prosecutor and the victim can request those victims. About the official statistic that we have official statistics since 2003. But these statistics, as I told you, only reflect the victims of gender violence in the domestic sphere. These statistics are public and can be consulted by everyone at the link that I gave you in this presentation. On average, we can say that about 60 women are killed by their partners every year in my country. And around 10 or 15 children are also killed by their parents every year in my country. Another question is, do the judicial and law enforcement authority cooperate effectively in investigating and prosecuting domestic violence and violence against the women? This question is yes. Actually, a great effort has been made to train the agents involved with the victim of gender violence. And I have to say that I'm very proud of my country and the way that our judicial authority investigates and prosecutes this type of crimes. Next question asks about the victims. If victims trust the judicial system. Actually, I think that victims do not trust judicial system because many of the murder victims have no prior complaints. In the statistics that I told you before, we can see if the victims previously denounced or if they didn't tell to the authorities their situation. Okay, so this is an indicative of a lack of trust. But on the other way, we can also say that the mass majority of protection measures work. Why? Because most of the women that denounce, they are still alive. So I think the lack of confidence is probably due to the way television news inform us about breaches of protection orders. Also in Spain, television says every day the women that are murdered by their partners. So they indicate a woman was murdered by the partner and she had a protection order, or a woman was murdered by his partner and she hasn't a protection order, but they inform us of all the women that are murdered. What television do not does, and for me is a mistake, is at the end of the year say all the women that were protected by our police. Because I think that if the television would also say all the women that had high risk levels and our authorities protected them in a protected them in a good way, the mass majority of victims that do not trust our judicial system, they will trust our judicial system. Another question is if we have any criteria applied by the investigation authorities in criminal procedures for risk analysis. So yes, actually I will not have time to explain that, but we have an artificial intelligence system called Biogen that predicts the risk of repeat violence as well as the risk of homicide. So normally our agents use this algorithm in order to assess the risk of a victim. The Biogen system assesses the risk by interviewing the victim. This is problematic because even though the aggressor is the cause of the risk, this assessment depends on the subjective perception of the victim, because they do not include the interview of the aggressor in the algorithm. Another question is if there are special measures in our country to protect children's physical integrity and psychological health. So yes, since 2015, as I told you before, the Organic Act on Gender Violence includes minors as a passive subject of this type of violence. This allows them to have the same protection measures as their mothers. In addition, our Supreme Court has recognized them as direct victims, indicating that the presence of the minor in an environment of violence is already violence. Another question is the relationship of the investigating authorities with other institutions of the state and non-governmental organization. I consider that this relationship is good because the different social services are interconnected in order to offer the most complete protection to the victim and also to avoid the re-victimization that would mean having to repeat the same story in all the instances. Next question is, are victims of domestic violence provide with measures in the field of security, health, accommodation, and education in my country? And if non-governmental organizations contribute to these measures? Okay, so the answer to both questions is affirmative. Yes, they are shelters for victims of gender violence where they can go with their children if they have nowhere to stay. And they also have economic and psychosocial assistance in order to be able to escape their situation. Question about COVID, I think is difficult to answer because the data are contradictory. Homicides have been reduced, but not control violence, because control violence has increased. It is possible that with the end of the state of alarm in my country last May, however, here in Valencia, we have a different situation because we have still locked out during the night, but actually not in the rest of Spain. So we think that with the end of the state of alarm, the number of homicides will increase as the aggressor feels that he has lost control of the situation. During a year and a half, women have been at home with them. So the objective of the aggressor is never to kill the victim, is to have the victim under control. COVID-19 has given the aggressor the perfect situation in order to have her under control 24 hours per day. The moment this control disappears because we will have more freedom is the moment when we will have to see the number of homicides. What we know is that the calls to 016, that is the number that victims use in order to ask for psychological help or to this juridical advice, has increased a lot during coronavirus situation. So this means that violence didn't stop. Coronavirus was able to stop the war, but wasn't able to stop violence against women within the home that continued. I think, as I say, that we will have to wait to recover normality in order to see what happens, because we cannot say that gender violence is only homicides. Gender violence has lot of versions, so even though homicides have been reduced, control violence has increased. And just for the last question, is if there is any order or a specific issue I would like to specify regarding my legal system. And I would just like to finish highlighting the great work done by the Spanish legislator in the recent years. We only have to look back 20 years ago to see that Spanish society and legislation were completely different. The sadly famous case of Ángela González Carreño is an example of this. When the United Nations studied this case and indicated to the Spanish legislator what should be done to fight against gender violence in our country, the vast majority of the suggestion has already been implemented by the country. Much remains to be done, but I think that we are doing well. So this is the end of my speech, and I would like to reiterate my thanks to Professor Anders Sulzen for allowing me to participate in this event. Thank you very much.
Raquel, this is coming from Merve Nurduymaz. How is the role of civilian authority to prevent the violence? Are they effective?
So, I think that one of the most effective measures that we have to prevent violence, I think that they are two things to do. First one is to educate the society in order to try to change it. And I think that we are doing it well, but also education takes a lot of time. So what can we do if we are not using that? So what we have to do is to use criminal law. And some of the protective measures that we already have is the protection order, that I think that they are similar in all the country. So normally protection orders are effective when a judge tells you that if you keep on doing the same thing, you will go to jail. Normally people stop and they are effective. And also there are some police looking around the women in order to be sure that these protection orders are working well. Sometimes they are not effective, it is true, but I think every cautelar measure, not only in gender violence, but in everything, cannot be always protected. So I think that our civilian authorities do it well, but the problem is what I told you, that victims do not ask to these protection measures because the media send mistaken message, that is that they are not useful, or in the criminal courts they are not going to be believed, but it is not true.
Thank you, Raquel. Also, another question coming from Arya. what kind of contribution that United Nations had done previously toward preventing the gender-based violence, especially during the pandemic? Is any parties that might be involved? Thanks in advance, she said.
So I think that in my country, United Nations didn't done any contributions about our pandemic situation, only the general ones that they have done to all the countries, but not anything specifically to Spain. So sorry, but I won't be able to answer this question.
Thank you. And also, I think the last one from Hilal Çakır. Are there any correlation between no-fault divorce system and domestic violence cases? Do you think that no-fault divorce has caused a decrease in domestic violence cases against women?
Maybe, but I think that the most important in our country is that before, in order to divorce, you had to stay, like, I think it was 3 or 6 months together. So I think the non-fault divorce systems, it was not, but more the fact that before when people wanted to go to divorce, first thing that the judge made was to try to save the relationship. So the moment that two persons do not want to stay together and the judge said you are going to stay together, the normal thing is that violence is going to increase because it's two people that do not want to remain together anymore and you are forcing them to remain together. So the fact that divorce became so easy in Spain and also that we are more used to know that people are divorced, because maybe when I was a child, it was a strain to have your parents divorced. But nowadays it's easier and easier to know people that divorce. So I think that yes, this should be a cause of the decrease of the domestic violence, because the message sent to the society is so different. Before, the message was that love can change anybody and love can anything. So you just have to stay, and with love, anything will be solved. And now the message that we send to the society is that you do not have to stay in a place where you are not treated in a good way.
Thank you, Raquel. One more question from Ezgi. As far as I know, Spain ranks 8 in the EU on the gender equality index. According to this rate, violence against women is less, and can we say that the government of Spain can prevent it efficiently? What methods are followed? You already explained some of it, but please.
Yes, I think that some of the things that I'm really proud of my country is that we are one of the European countries that we have less violence. Even though maybe in Germany, in France, or in England, they think that we have more violence because we are from the Mediterranean and we are Latin or stuff that people think from Spanish people, this is not true. We have really few violence. And I think that we have really few violence because our legislator in 2004, when he created the Organic Act, said, okay, this is a crime against human rights, and I'm not gonna permit that these crimes continue in my country. So they had done a lot of campaigns, they have put a lot of resources in the criminal courts in order to be able to change the mentality on the people. Is what I told, the mentality is difficult to change from a day to another day, but it has been done a lot in order to fight against this. And at the end of the day, we can see that we are one of the European Union countries that we have less gender violence in the country. So what can we do to prevent it efficiently? As I told before, I think prevention starts on education. We are facing this problem because during a lot of, if you could see Organic Act, in our Organic Act, they say that in order to fight against gender violence, we have to fight using four disciplines. So first one, say education, and indicates that we have to say education in order to being able to change all this attitude. Second one speaks about the sanitary level. It says that the doctors has to be the one to see if a person is being in a gender violent situation, and if they think that, they have to inform the authorities. Third one, they speak about the media. They say that the media has to give a fair information and not only speak about the crime, because we all want to know like how much blood it was. They also have to give fair information in order to being able to realize of the situation. And fourth one, speak about the criminal law. So criminal law is the moment the failure was made, criminal law will start. Before, we have all these to change. The problem is that everything needs like lots of economic investment. And at the beginning, we just started with the last one, with the criminal law. So with the criminal law, we changed the mentalities, but only because of fear. No one wants to go to the jail. And nowadays, we are implementing also the other parts. We are going to education that should have been the first one, but at the beginning, we didn't have the resources in order to do that. So at the beginning, we started with criminal law, and now we are using all the other parts of this law.
Thank you for this like detailed answer. I think there is no question. So we can finish this Spain report. And thank you for this lovely presentation, Raquel. I hope see you face to face next year.
I also hope so, because I really want to visit Istanbul. So I hope we all be vaccinated and we will be able to travel.
We hope we will be glad. Thank you. And the Switzerland report will start at 1:25.
Okay, so thank you very much and be safe.
Thank you, Raquel.